Well, good afternoon. From the beginning of this pandemic, our government has made it very clear that nothing is more important than the health of our long-term care residents. We have a duty to protect them, and we made a promise to do whatever it takes to improve their conditions and ensure they receive the highest quality of care. Part of that commitment is to provide them with the average of 4 hours of care per day. Today, we're taking another step forward, delivering on that commitment. And I am pleased to announce that we're investing $115 million to train 8,200 new personal support workers in our long-term care and home and community care sectors. This is part of our government's long-term care staffing strategy, one of the largest PSW recruitment and training drives ever in this country's history. This represents the biggest increase in PSW training capacity in a generation through the Accelerated Personal Support Workers Training Program. We'll be offering tuition-free training to 6,000 students. This program will allow them to complete their studies in 6 months instead of 8, getting additional help to the front lines faster. We're rolling up our sleeves with all 24 colleges here in Ontario to get this fully funded program up and running starting in April. We're also offering $2,000 tuition assistance to nearly 2,200 students that are already completing a PSW program at an Ontario public college. These initiatives will lead to historic improvements in the quality of life and care for our seniors. I said we would fix this broken system, and this is how we're going to do it. This is how we correct decades of neglect. During this pandemic, our PSWs have carried a very, very heavy burden, and we can't thank them enough. Our PSWs have had our backs, and with today's announcement, we are showing them that we have their backs as well. And the vaccine rollout to long-term care is absolutely critical and has been very, very successful. We've administered over 167,000 vaccine doses to long-term care and retirement home residents and staff. In fact, every resident and staff person in every one of our long-term care homes who wanted a vaccine has received a vaccine. We're making progress, but we have more work to do in our fight against this terrible virus. And adding this needed capacity to our PSW team is a critical step in our road to recovery. Thank you, and God bless the people of Ontario. Now I'll hand it over to Minister Fullerton.
Thank you, Premier. It's great to be here today to join you alongside Minister Romano for this important announcement. Personal support workers are the backbone of long-term care and do vital work every day so that our loved ones receive the quality of care they need and deserve. Our government is committed to modernizing long-term care, and this means having the needed levels of well-trained staff to support our most vulnerable. To honor this commitment, we have taken many steps. In December, we announced the most historic staffing plan in the history of long-term care. 2 weeks ago, we announced an innovative new program at Willis College that will train 300 PSWs and will provide hands-on clinical experience from the very beginning of their training. On Monday, we announced $4.1 million to help train 373 new PSWs. And today, we are announcing over $115 million to help train an additional 8,200 new personal support workers under a similar innovative new model. 6,000 of these students will be receiving a fully government-funded PSW education, as well as paid placements for their workplace-based learning. To ensure that PSW students who are already enrolled in a program are recognized for their existing commitment with Ontario's publicly funded colleges, we will also be providing paid placements to 2,200 students. It's important to note that the PSWs trained through this program will be introduced to the work environment very early in their training and will provide hands-on support to the ongoing COVID-19 response. This will give students early experiences working within the broader health and long-term care system. We're committed to providing an average of 4 hours of daily direct care to all residents, and to achieve this, we will need many more PSWs. We will be looking to all our training partners to bring forward innovative solutions so we can give our seniors the best care in the country. These actions make Ontario a leader in Canada. Being a personal support worker is meaningful and rewarding work. And when we talk about heroes, PSWs immediately come to mind. Residents and their families repeatedly express how important they are in their daily lives. Having worked as a family physician for almost 3 decades, and as a daughter who had a parent in long-term care, I deeply appreciate the difficult and rewarding work that frontline healthcare staff provide. To those of you who may be considering training as a personal support worker, I encourage you to apply to one of the 24 Ontario colleges offering a fully funded PSW training program, thanks to today's announcement. We need you, and our loved ones need you. And I'm so grateful for all the work that our frontline heroes do. You are there every day, providing tireless support to our most vulnerable. Together, we will address the long-standing staffing challenges that have impacted this sector for decades. Together, we will make long-term care a better place for residents to live and a better place for staff to work. Thank you. And I'll now pass it over to the Minister of Colleges and Universities, Ross Romano.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you very much for the opportunity to speak with you today. We recognize that if we want to increase the number of frontline healthcare workers in Ontario, we must be determined, we must be innovative and collaborative. Our post-secondary education sector has been and will continue to be critical in this effort. Ontario's institutions continue to deliver excellent programs that prepare graduates for high-demand frontline jobs. Today, I'm so pleased that Ontario is partnering with our publicly assisted colleges, as well as Colleges Ontario, to create a rapid training program that will qualify PSWs for high-demand jobs in Ontario's health and long-term care sectors. Throughout the COVID-19 outbreak, our publicly assisted colleges have stepped up time and time again, from donating PPE to frontline healthcare institutions, or quickly pivoting from in-person to online delivery to make sure that no student of ours lost a year of study. Our colleges have demonstrated unwavering commitment to delivering results for Ontario, as well as Ontario students. The Ontario government is committed to supporting the post-secondary sector, and we will continue to work with our partners to create programs that are flexible and responsive to our labor market needs. This will help ensure that Ontarians can upgrade their skills and join the workforce more quickly. Part of our long-term care staffing plan commits to dramatically increasing the supply of our healthcare workers. The program that is announced here today will be a major contributor to achieving our goals. To achieve success, we will continue to work closely with the Ministries of Health and Long-Term Care and all of our post-secondary institutions to ensure that students receive the skills and the education that they need to be part of a high-quality PSW workforce in Ontario. I want to encourage everyone who is interested in our province to apply for this training through one of your local public colleges once the enrollment opens in early March. I want to thank you, and I want to thank Premier Ford and Minister Fullerton for the excellent work that has been going on in this file. I look forward to continuing to support any way we can. Thank you.
That's great. Thanks, Minister. Folks, before we take questions, I want to take a minute to talk about the vaccine rollout. I know it's on everyone's mind right now, and it's the only thing I'm thinking about. And when I say I'm the only thing, I don't sleep at night thinking of this. And it's our top priority in getting the vaccines into people's arms. It's the most important task at hand right now. And we have a great plan, and we're executing it. And right now, that means focusing on our top priority populations. Fully vaccinating our long-term care homes, residents in our retirement homes, vaccinating our frontline healthcare heroes, I call them, and remote communities. That's critical in phase one. These are the most vulnerable groups. These are who we're focused on in phase one of our plan. And this is the task at hand, and that's what we're focused on. And we're making tremendous program. I mean, progress, I should say. You know, we're leading the country. When I say we're doing tremendous progress, this is an example. We're leading the entire country in the number of vaccines administered. Like, I mean, you can add up all the vaccines in the entire country and all the provinces. Ontario alone is giving more vaccines than anyone. In fact, we have more people in Ontario who are fully vaccinated who have received both shots than all the provinces combined. And I can't wait for the day where we're able to do more, but we're limited by one thing, and I keep saying it. We need vaccines. It's a game changer. And I know General Hillier is spending every waking moment, and he's doing a great job, by the way, planning for the future. That's what generals do. They just, you know, he looks at the task at hand, but good generals, good commanders, they look at what's going down the road, where are we going to be in March, April, May, so on and so forth, and planning for the future for when we have more vaccines. So I appreciate the work that General Hillier is doing. And folks, until then, we'll continue doing what's needed most, and that's getting vaccines into the arms of the most vulnerable. And that's what we're going to focus on, the task at hand. Allie, we're ready for the questions.
We'll go to the phone line for questions. First question, please.
Your first question comes from Stephanie Smith with CP24. Please go ahead.
Hi, Stephanie.
Thank you. Hi, Premier. I understand that, you know, you say you're limited, and more Ontarians are being vaccinated than any other in the province, but
nope.
How do we compare this with Alberta right now, where today seniors over 75 being offered a vaccine? Starting today, how is it that Ontario, of all provinces in this country, is, you know, so far behind in that sense?
Well, I'm going to respectfully disagree. We're far behind. We're leading the whole country. We're doing more than Alberta, BC. You combine all the vaccinations in the entire country, Ontario's doing more. So I don't know how we're falling behind on that. But in saying that, let's look at Alberta. Let's take Alberta, then I'll move over to Quebec, and they're both great provinces, both great premiers there. They put up their website, bang, it's crashed. We want to make sure we nail this. We have it down pat. So their website crashed, and then we look at Quebec. They're a great province, great premier. They haven't administered one single dose of the second vaccine, the second dose. So, you know, I have all the confidence in the world with General Hillier. I have all the confidence in the world in our public health units, our hospitals, our paramedics, everyone that's come together, and we're focusing on the task at hand. And the task at hand right now is the priority populations, and that's what we're going to focus on.
Follow up?
Yeah, thank you. Speaking of those priority populations,
yep.
We understand that, you know, you're putting together that list of the essential workers. Is there anything you can tell us more about that beyond phase one? So we're talking teachers, yeah. Police officers. We've just been reporting on an outbreak at the police college and at 31 yeah. Division in Toronto. What more can you tell us about the next steps with those who you are listing as most important essential workers?
Yeah, Stephanie, I think that's a great question, but really right now I'm focusing on the priority populations. And yes, when we get to the essential workers, in other phases, phase two, and that's going to be rolled out then, but we're still a while away from that, a little ways away from that, I should say. And, you know, the bottom line is we need vaccines. If we had millions of vaccines, it'd be a lot easier. But right now, making sure that we vaccinate the most vulnerable, making sure that we focus on the frontline, you know, caregivers that are dealing with COVID patients, that's a priority, and we need more vaccines to get that done. So that's what we're focused on, and when we get to that point, everyone will know when their turn is coming.
Next question.
Your next question comes from Graham Richardson with CTV Ottawa. Please go ahead.
How you doing, Graham?
Hi, Premier, to this point, my in-laws in Alberta today are in their 70s. They're trying to book their shots.
Yep.
My parents in Ontario have to wait. Yep. And I've been asked why that is, and I still don't have a clear answer. Is it that, can you give me a clear answer about why there's a longer delay for 80-year-olds in Ontario than there are for people, let's say, in Alberta?
Yeah, that's an easy one, and thanks for that question, Graham. The population of Alberta is a little over 4 million. We're upwards to 15 million, and as simple as that. We have a lot more long-term care patients. We have a lot more staff. We have a lot more, seniors, residents. I think long-term care, and I'll pass this over to the minister, where we have over 70,000 patients, not to mention the workers, and then the seniors, residents. It's just sheer numbers. If I had the numbers that Alberta has, we'd be done. We're already 600,000 doses out there. That's more than the whole country, so they're doing pretty good. I'll pass it over to the minister.
Yeah, thank you, Premier. You know, that's absolutely it. We have larger numbers of people in long-term care, larger numbers of staff to do. Those were the priorities set by this government, and thankfully so. We see our numbers coming down of resident cases, outbreaks, staff cases. We're really trending in a very positive direction now. In terms of things becoming much more manageable in long-term care. And also I want to thank the public health units, the medical officers of health, everyone who's been working round the clock to get the vaccines, not only to our priority population of long-term care staff and residents and essential caregivers, but also who are planning with us this process to get out to the next groups. And certainly, you know, my mother's 88 years old. I know how important it is that we get to this group, and this is happening. It will happen soon. Once we have the vaccines, and this is such an important point, we need that pipeline of steady vaccines. We have the capacity to vaccinate. We need the vaccines, and I know people are working on that, and I want to thank them too. But many thanks to the medical officers of health who are putting out very specialized plans in their regions. So thank you.
Follow up.
And Bringer, we've been getting a lot of questions from viewers who are, let's say, 35, 40, 55 years old, who are ill or have other conditions. And all that the media has been talking about, because all the governments has been talking about, are ages.
Mm-hmm.
Is age the only thing you're going to look at in terms of a timeline for vaccinations? What can you say to people who have other conditions that make them vulnerable? Will they move up in the queue, or do they have to wait?
Well, good question, Graham. And we're really focusing just on phase one, and we have a little ways to go still on that. And then I'm sure the other areas of the population, that will be rolled out too. But my number one priority is the task at hand and making sure that, we focus on those priority populations. We make sure that we have all the long-term care workers and patients done, and also in the retirement homes. And I hear you, and I love the passion, Graham, that you said about your parents. And I know you love your parents, and I love mine. I don't have them anymore, but I hear everyone. And my priority is to make sure the parents, the grandparents, are taken care of like as soon as possible. So I appreciate that. And there's one thing, and I don't know where your parents live. I know you're in Ottawa, but I've done it before. Maybe I shouldn't do it, but I'm going to do it anyways. I got it because we have so many great PHU public health units. We have so many great hospitals. But do you know who just, I don't know, leads the pack all the time is Ottawa, Dr. Etches and Cam Love from Ottawa. Like, they never have to be told anything. They take it, they run with it, they jump ahead and just start moving forward. And they're just two incredible leaders. And it just shows how important within public health units and hospitals, what leadership does. When you have strong leaders, and we have a lot of them, I just mentioned too, there's dozens of them across the province. So I'm confident when we have more vaccines, we'll be able to really ramp this up.
Next question.
Your next question comes from Natasha McDonald with Radio Canada. Please go ahead.
Hi, Natasha.
Hi, Premier. I'm wondering, since we're talking about PSWs, will the temporary raises for PSWs that expire in March be extended or made permanent? And what proportion of these new PSW students will be trained in French?
Yeah, great question, Natasha. Man, I'll tell you, they deserve everything they got, the $3 an hour increase. And geez, I'm going to talk about lobbying. I'll be lobbying me and everyone else. We need to keep that $3 an hour. Simple. We're going to do whatever it takes. These people, number one, for years were underpaid, overworked, understaffed. We're going to change the system. We're going to make sure they're paid fairly. We're going to make sure we're ramping up the staffing, and we're going to make sure they're treated with the utmost respect. But did you know who gets all the credit? Dr. Fullerton. Not me. Not Ross. Ross is part of it too. You know, Minister Romano, he has the colleges. But the person that's out there every single day, that is on the phone every single day, I talk to constantly, is Merrilee Fullerton, or Minister Fullerton, Dr. Fullerton. She's the champion. I'll pass it over to the minister.
Thank you, Premier. And, you know, this whole sector has languished for decades. And we've all been through the last year. It's been a challenging year. But there is tremendous hope that we can repair and rebuild and advance this sector. It starts with building the capacity and the staffing. And you can see our commitment. First of all, we announced the Willis College, the 300 PSWs there, the 373 that we just announced with the Ministry of Labor and Training and Skills Development. This is a monumental lift. But we're doing it, 6,000 new PSW positions and 2,200 in the pipeline to be fully funded with grants and support through the 24 Ontario colleges. So this is a monumental lift. In terms of the language, La Cité and the Collège Boreal will both be offering French training for the PSWs. This is very important to me, very important to our Minister of Francophone Affairs. And I understand how important it is for people in their time of vulnerability, in their end of life, to be supported with language that is familiar to them. So I understand that their emotional well-being is very important, and I look forward to being able to provide that French language training.
Follow-up?
My follow-up question is for Minister Romano, from my colleagues at Radio Canada in Sudbury. The Ontario Confederation of University Faculty Association said they were told by ministry representatives that the government won't determine next steps until after Laurentian University has been restructured. So I'm wondering if you could give more details about that, and if that's true, why wait after job losses and potential cuts to, let's say, French programs to take action?
Thank you very much for that question. I want to start off by saying we're all very deeply concerned about what's happening at Laurentian University. The university is in CCAA protection. I can advise the individuals from that university and certainly from the community of Sudbury, having been from Sault Ste. Or being from Sault Ste. Marie and having experienced our largest employer in all of Northern Ontario, Algoma Steel at the time, SR Steel, going through creditor protection through CCAA proceedings was a very difficult situation for the entire community. And I know that it is one that the entire community is monitoring, and we are monitoring very closely. We are very concerned for the students, and we want to ensure that no student is going to be impacted as a result of what is occurring in the CCAA proceedings. CCAA is a process that is before the courts. Ontario, the government of Ontario is not a party to the proceedings, and therefore it would be inappropriate to discuss what's happening in the court proceedings. I just want to stress that the number one concern for us as we go through this process at the ministry level, and certainly for our government, is every student in the community of Laurentian, and certainly within the region of Northern Ontario and the Sudbury community. We're looking at the situation very closely. I think it's important that we really focus on the news that we're here today speaking about. Minister Fullerton has put a great deal of time, as Premier Ford has noted here today, into the amazing work of our PSW sector and the importance of trying to get more of our PSWs trained to support our long-term care homes and all of our loved ones out there who need this level of care. And I'm just very happy to be able to support the Premier, Minister Fullerton, on this very important announcement today. Thank you.
Last question.
Your final question comes from Randy Roth with CHCH TV. Please go ahead.
Hi, Randy. How you doing?
Yeah, hi. Back to the starters. We've been this with the pandemic for a year, and we've known that PSWs has been a big problem, but there not being enough of them for that entire time. Why has it taken so long? Why has it taken a year before you launched this project?
I'll pass that over to the minister, or which one wants it?
I can start. I can start. So we really looked at three major efforts during this pandemic: the emergency response, the stabilization, and then the longer term planning. Really, these had to be done at the same time. We never really dropped the ball at all in terms of the long range plan, which we had initiated since the very beginning of our ministry back in the summer of 2019. So that was ongoing. But given the difficulties in our homes, we had to have a rapid response. And so we were looking at ways to make sure our homes could receive the staffing that they needed. And it was a major challenge, as everyone knows. Getting the hospital integration, getting the people deployed quickly, the rapid response teams, the resident support aides, the mobile enhancement support teams going in there. We really pulled out every stop to make sure that we could get staff into the homes and support them. But there is a much bigger lift, longer term, to meet our 27,000 spaces that we need for our commitment to 4 hours of direct care on average per resident per day. This is what we need to create real significant quality improvements in our long-term care homes. And our PSWs that have been on the front lines holding the line during COVID, my heart goes out to them and everyone who's been affected. It's been a challenging time. We are turning the corner. We are staying vigilant. We are making sure that we are ready for anything that comes. But there has to be this longer-term planning to meet the capacity requirements and the staffing requirements that go along with that. So we have kept our eye on the ball this whole time. Thank you. Minister Romano, did you want to comment?
Perhaps I'll just simply add all our institutions, all of our publicly funded institutions, our colleges provide PSW training in the province of Ontario. A number of our universities also in Ontario provide similar training. I think that Ontario has demonstrated leadership in this charge from the beginning. When you look at the start of the pandemic, and the extra pay that was paid towards PSWs just to try to encourage more people who are A, in the profession, and B, others who might be looking to the profession. And we continue to work very closely with our colleges. I've had numerous conversations with Colleges Ontario about this subject matter. And I think Ontario institutions and our government has done a tremendous job of trying to lead the charge in this area. And we will continue to ask anyone out there looking at a great career to consider a career as a PSW or other healthcare field. We need you, our people need you, and we ask everybody, please contact your local public colleges in your region and consider taking the course that is being made available through this excellent announcement here today. Thank you.
Follow up?
Yeah, and going forward, will you ensure that PSWs have paid sick days? And I don't mean just during COVID. I mean after COVID is over, you know, just to keep everyone safe, shouldn't these people have paid sick days? And if you're not going to ensure that, why not?
Pass it over to the minister.
Thank you. You know, it's an important question. When we look at how the difficulties of retaining PSWs, and over the years, half of a class would be leaving their training before they graduate, and then the portion that did graduate, half of those would be gone from the sector within 2 years. So we have to look at measures that will retain our PSWs, and part of that you've seen with our pandemic pay and then the temporary wage increase, but it's about stabilizing the sector for the longer term and creating a better place to work and a better place to live for our residents. And so the everything we have to understand about the environment in which our PSWs work. What is it that will retain them? And we're learning, this is a continuous learning process. We've learned a lot from COVID, and I believe that we're on the right track in terms of providing the supports and resources that our PSWs need. And we'll continue to innovate with these very important programs. So I just want to thank all the ministries that have been involved and all our sector partners and all the colleges that have been involved. So it's a monumental lift to support this sector and move it forward into the 21st century. And that's exactly what we'll be doing. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Okay. Thank you, everyone.